All right, this may not be the way that you thought Psalm 59 would start, or I'd start Psalm 59 having just heard it, but there is a brilliant Saturday Night Live skit, and it has two of my favorite Saturday Night Live characters, Jimmy Fallon and Justin Timberlake, in it, and it's all about hashtags. Maybe you've seen this. So Jimmy Fallon walks in, and Justin Timberlake is sitting on a couch, and he says, "Hey, Justin, what's up?" "Not much, Jimmy. Hashtag chillin'. What's up with you?" "Just busy working. Hashtag rise and grind. Hashtag is it Friday yet?" "Hey, I brought you some cookies. Hashtag homemade. Hashtag oatmeal raisin. Hashtag show me the cookie." This is Jimmy now. "Hashtag don't mind if I don't. These are good. Hashtag get my cookie on. Hashtag I'm the real cookie monster. Hashtag blah, 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 blah." Maybe you've seen it. I saw a t-shirt the other day. Chuck, I'm trying not to look at you right now. A woman was wearing it. She was likely in her 60s, and she was clearly a grandmother. And she wanted the world to know that she's a grandmother. The t-shirt said this: "Love them, spoil them, give them back." And then, as if it was a nod to Jimmy Fallon and Justin Timberlake, the t-shirt ended with, "Hashtag grandma life." Okay, here's where I'm going. I think it is our temptation at times, in some ways, to think of God in the same way. We walk into a room and God is sitting there, and he asks us what we're doing and how we're doing. We say, "Man, just grinding. And is it the weekend yet? Because this life is hard." And we just want God to say, "Yo, hey man, I made these cookies for you. They will make you happy. Just eat them. Hashtag whatever you want. Hashtag just want to see you happy. Hashtag your heavenly grandfather." Right? Or we want God to be a heavenly grandmother who just loves us and dotes on us and just whatever you want. Hashtag grandma life. Okay, here, there is a huge problem with this, right? There's a huge problem with this, approaching God this way. Here's why. That's just clearly not how life is. That's not how life is. And in some ways you could say that's clearly is not how God interacts with us, even though we tend to want to approach him that way. Okay, so again, we're in the Psalms. We're in the Psalms for this summer, as we have been for the last 9 summers together. And finally, we're up to Psalm 59. And maybe you noticed this, but actually for the 5th time in the 50s of the Psalms, we're actually told why, the context around which David wrote the particular psalm. So let me rehearse some of these for you. Psalm 52 said this, that it was to the choir master, a maskil of David, when Doeg, the Edomite, came and told Saul, "David has come to the house of Ahimelech." Psalm 54 said this, to the choir master with stringed instruments, a maskil of David, when the Ziphites went and told Saul, "Is not David hiding among us?" Psalm 56, to the choir master, according to dove on far-off terebinths. I would love to hear that tune. A miktam of David when the Philistines seized him in Gath. 57, to the choir master, according to do not destroy. A miktam of David when he fled from Saul in the cave. 59, what we're in now. Finally, to the choir master, according to do not destroy, a miktam of David when Saul sent men to watch his house in order to kill him. Here's why I go through those really quickly. Just in the 50s alone, each one is in this setting where things are not remotely going well for David. And I just read you the ones that actually had headers, but if we actually just walked our way through some of the other ones, which we will do in a moment, what you will see is there's no kind of life presented for us here where God is just sort of some grandmother in heaven wanting to give us cookies. Not one of the Psalms. Not one of these psalms around here give us that kind of idea. David has been anointed by Samuel. You may remember this in 1 Samuel. And Samuel's God's prophet. And he anointed David to be the next king of Israel. And for the most part, after that happens, it seems like things are just not going David's way. They're not really terribly positive. Let me sort of walk through some of what we've actually seen just there where I just mentioned those headings, okay? Doeg the Edomite, he comes with King Saul's blessing to Ahimelech in the town of Nob, and he kills Ahimelech and all of the other priests. That was a priestly town where the priests primarily lived. He kills all the priests and all their families in pursuit of David because Ahimelech had hidden David. Okay, what we had read next was that David fled that area to the Ziphites, where actually, if you read it, what you can see is that David's men helped out the Ziphites in any way that they could, and yet the Ziphites betrayed David. And that's a situation, of course, way worse than like your little brother betraying your hiding spot when you're playing hide and seek with your dad. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's betrayal. This is big time betrayal, okay? Then David is hiding in Philistia. Philistia is not friendly to God's people. That's where David, you know, took a donkey jawbone and went to town. Samson, thank you. But what he does, he acts mad and crazy in order to leave Philistia because they're out to get him. And then we read of David hiding in the caves of Adullam that we recently read. And now finally, we're actually in this little section in Psalm 59 where it's actually David sort of walking through, he's walked through all of these different events which have been chronological. But now in Psalm 59, he's remembering, you know what, it was actually crazy even to begin with. So he remembers back to a time before these initial events. Namely, he remembers his life back in 1 Samuel 19 before he was fleeing from Saul. And I want to read you this because this is the context in which this psalm was written. 1 Samuel 19, verse 11. Saul sent messengers to David's house to watch him, that he might kill him in the morning. But Michal, David's wife, told him, "If you do not escape with your life tonight, tomorrow you will be killed." So Michal let David down through the window, and he fled away and escaped. Michal took an image and laid it on the bed and put a pillow of goat's hair at its head and covered it with the clothes. That's a smart woman. And when Saul sent messengers to take David, she said, "He is sick." Then Saul sent the messengers to see David, saying, "Bring him up to me in the bed that I may kill him." And when the messengers came in, behold, the image was in the bed with the pillow of goat's hair at its head. Saul said to Michal, "Why have you deceived me thus and let my enemies go so that he's escaped?" And Michal answered Saul, "He said to me, 'Let me go. Why should I kill you?'" Why am I reading all this again? Why go into all this? What seems very, very clear, at least in this collection of psalms that we have for us, is that the world is not as it should be. And you're entirely dependent on God doing something about it. What you must rest in is this idea of God's steadfast love for you. Because time and time and time again in David's life, he keeps recounting, and then he actually goes, you know what, even before I started, I can go back farther to look at how things are conspiring against me. People are surrounding me. They're out for my life. The world is not as it's meant to be. I mean, listen again. Okay, let me recount some of these again for you, okay? Psalm 58, just last week, we saw that David was crying out for God's justice to be brought upon leaders who abused their power. The world is not as it's meant to be. And we're to actually rest in this idea that the Lord says, "Vengeance is mine. I will repay." Right before that, Psalm 57 told us how we can sing to the Lord about his salvation even in the midst of a violent world, because he always hears the cries of his people. His cry, his steadfast love, we heard, will never end, and that his glory is above the heavens. Psalm 56 told us that the Lord sees, this was so beautiful, the Lord sees all of our tears and he keeps them bottled up in his bottle. None of your tears are ever lost on him. He knows all of your pain. Psalm 55 told us that we're supposed to cast our burdens on the Lord and he will sustain us. Psalm 54 told us God is a helper who upholds our life when it's falling apart. Psalm 53 told us that when God looks down on the earth, he sees no one seeking after him, But he also promises there that he will restore his people. Psalm 52 told us that God will not let those who he loves be devoured by others, whether their words or their actions. Psalm 51, that famous confession psalm, says that actually we're all accomplices in the evil and the sin of the world. Again, why am I going into all this? I'm recounting these psalms because there's no way you can go to the Bible and really read it and really devote yourself to it and leave with some idea that God is the great cookie giver and that he's the great grandfather in the sky. Or that God is sort of blind to how awful the world really is at times. Abuse of power and violence and tears and burdens and falling apart, knowing no one seeking after him, words that devour, people that seek harm, sin infestation. I think David or the psalmist, whoever compiled all of these psalms together, knew exactly what he's doing when he's putting them all together. In some sense, he's recounting how overwhelming all of this is. So this is what we have in Psalm 59. David cries out for deliverance. Keep your bulletin open to Psalm 59. Let's look at the beginning here, right? He cries out for deliverance in Psalm or in verses 1 and 2. And we have him describe this situation that he's in. Verse 3, they lie in wait for my life. I mean, literally, and you remember that story where they're actually surrounding David's household as he flees, and Michal, his wife, covers for him. Verse 4, they run and they make ready. Verse 5, they plot evil. But what I want you to see is that when we're surrounded by this situation that just seems literally overwhelming, people are literally around his house, and it seems like everything is against him. When we're overcome with the brokenness of this life, when we find ourselves asking questions in this world of why is sin allowed and why is everything so broken, what David tells us here is even in the midst of that situation, God's love is not absent. There's peace in the midst of this kind of absolute turmoil and this seemingly nonstop being barraged by how broken things are and how messed up they are and how sin infested everything is. God's love isn't absent. It's not missing or nowhere to be found. It may not be like the great, you know, cookie giver or the grandma in the sky, but it's still altogether present. I want you to see this, okay? I want you to see the structure of this psalm and how the structure is teaching us this, really. So look with me down at verses 5 through 7, then I want us to jump down to actually verse 12 through 15. Okay. So actually, it's halfway through verse 4. Awake, come to meet me and see. You, Lord God of hosts, are a God of Israel. Rouse yourself to punish all the nations. He's saying things have gotten so out of hand. Spare none of those who treacherously plot evil. Do something about the evil in the world. And then you see Selah. Each evening they come back, howling like dogs and prowling about the city. There they are, bellowing with their mouths, with swords in their lips, for who they think will hear us. We go down to verse 12. I'm going to start again halfway through that, at the 4, right above 13. For the cursing and lies that they utter, consume them in wrath, consume them till they are no more, that they may know that God rules over Jacob to the ends of the earth. He's saying again, do something about this. Act, Lord. And again, he says, Selah. Then again, each evening they come back, howling like dogs and prowling about the city. They wander about for food and growl if they do not get their fill.